Welcome to the ninth video of the Blender 2.8 Beginners Tutorial Series. In this video, we will create the materials for the bowl and the wooden planks. And for that, we will use some special techniques which don't use any UV maps. For the bowl, we will use procedural textures only. And for the wooden planks, we will use seamless textures. If you have no clue what this means, you will know after watching this video. As always, you can find the timestamps in the video description below. And to follow along, you can sign up to our resource section free of charge to download all the project files and videos of this tutorial series and also our handy Blender 2.8 shortcut PDF. You can find the link down below in the video description. Hi everyone, Zach here for cgboost.com and let's get started. First of all, we are here in the shading workspace. Now let's hide basically everything except the bowl and select this over here and let's create a new material and call it bowl. As you maybe remember, we didn't create any UV map for this object, nor we created any textures. Here I want to use computer generated procedural textures to create a very simple metal material. So down here in the shader editor, I hit Shift A to add a new node. Then let's go over to texture. And as you maybe remember, we can add image textures like photographs of different surfaces, which we used for the apple and the knife. But also we have a bunch of other textures like a brick texture, checker, a gradient, a magic, whatever this means, or Musgrave. And we also have a noise texture. So all of these are so-called procedural textures. So if I add the noise texture, you can see we don't can open an image from our hard drive. This is just a simple node with a few values over here. And if I connect this, the color output to the base color of our principal node, you can see we got this colorful noise. A procedural texture is basically a computer-generated texture created by a certain algorithm, which adds certain pattern to our objects, or in this case, this colorful noise. And certainly we don't want to have this colorful bowl here, but we can use this noise texture in many creative ways. So this noise texture has a few values. For example, we can change the scaling of the noise. We can change the detail level. You can see now it's very blurry, but if I increase the details, we have more information in the noise. And we could even distort this if we like. Let's set the distortion down to 0. We can tweak these values in a second. But for now, since the texture is a bit stretched here, I hit Shift A down here, go to Input, and add a texture coordinate node. By default, this noise texture uses the generated texture coordinates. You can see there's no difference if I plug this in here. But sadly, this stretches the texture a bit. But there's a quick way to solve this by simply using the object texture coordinates. Let's plug it in here, and then you can see we won't have any stretching. So this is basically what we need to know about the texture coordinate node right now. Now the texture hasn't any stretching anymore. And we don't want to use this for the color. We want to use this for creating a very simple roughness map and a simple bump map. But before we do that, let's put this out here. I changed the color to a grayish tone, maybe add a little bit of reddish, and then increase the metallic value to 1. Now if we reduce the roughness here, as you can see, we have a very simple metallic bowl already. But I don't want to have this perfect smooth looking surface. I want to have a more rough handmade looking bowl. So let's start by creating a very simple roughness map. Let's hit Shift A, go down to Converter and add again a color ramp. Let's plug this in here. And then let's plug this into the roughness. Now with this black and white gradient here, we can control which parts of the surface should be relatively rough and which should be relatively smooth. So we have this uneven, not perfect looking surface. And I think the two values here of roughly 5 already looks quite good. And we have to see this in combination with the bump map to tweak it a bit further if we need to. So let's left-click select the noise texture, Shift-D, duplicate it, and left-click places down here. Also connect this with the object texture coordinates, so we don't have any stretching in the bump map too. And then let's hit Shift-A again, vector, and add a bump node. Connect the color output with the height, and the normal output with the normal input of the principal shader. Now, as you can see, this is certainly way too strong. Let's reduce this down to 0.05. And now we have this uneven surface. Let's reduce the scale a bit, increase the details. Now you can see we have much more finer details. And now we have this nice looking bowl. Maybe let's reduce the reddish tone a bit, not too much. Maybe increase the brightness of the dark values here for the roughness map a bit. And maybe reduce them from the white values a bit. So, and I think that looks good already. Remember, most of the bowl will be covered with the fabric anyway. But certainly we will see a few parts of the bowl, so this needs a material as well, but it doesn't have to be super detailed. But yeah, I think that looks fine here. Just a little side note here, since this material here does not need a UV map, we can use this material on any other object and it will look perfect. So for example, if I enable the apple once again, put it over here and remove the material, let's simply select this bowl. And then over here in the material tab, let's left click and hold on the material library icon. And then we can simply drag and drop the selected material onto other objects. Now you can see we have a metal apple. And for example, let's also unhide the knife here. Let's move it up. And if you don't want to drag and drop this from other selected objects, you can also simply change the selected material to from the bowl. So I can change this to this one. And now we have this metal on all the objects and you can see this works perfectly fine. The only thing you have to take care about, if you scale your objects in object mode, you can also see that I'm scaling the details of this texture. And again here, it's important to check your scale value and if needed, apply this. And then you can see that the size of the material or of the texture is also changing. So again, even for texturing, as you can see, the apply scale value is important. So certainly we don't want to have a metal knife and a metal apple, although this looks quite cool. Anyway, I will quickly undo this. Now let's unhide the wooden planks here. And I keep the bowl enabled here to have a scale reference. Let's select the wooden planks and let's create a new material here. Let's call it wood. And as you remember, we haven't created a proper UV map for this, but we don't want to use a procedural texture here. We want to use a so-called seamless texture, and we will use a projection method to basically project the 2D image onto this 3D model without using a UV map. And this works pretty well if you have flat surfaces. So again, from an external folder, I drag and drop this image here, which I've prepared for you, into the shader editor. Then we have this nice image texture node. And if I connect this to the base color here, we can see a weird looking texture on the wooden planks. And that's because if I quickly switch over to the UV editing workspace, there is a UV map on this object already since we started to model the wooden planks by using a cube. And a default cube always has a simple default UV map already. But this certainly doesn't fit to the new model here. So we basically can ignore this. We want to use a different method, similar to the one we used for the bowl here. So let's hit Shift A down here, go to Input and add the texture coordinate node. And similar for the bowl here, we use the object texture coordinate and connect this with the wood texture. Now you can see what seamless means. We basically can put this image side by side and we don't see where one image ends and the other begins because we have a smooth transition here. Certainly we can tell it a little bit by the repetition of the patterns here. Anyway, a seamless texture is great to cover large areas with texture without like hand painting everything. Also, this gives us the opportunity to have a much higher quality on large areas because if you, for example, stretch a 2K image on a large ground area, you will have a very bad resolution. Certainly the texture is now scaled way too small. So what we have to do, let's hit Shift A down here, go to Vector and add a mapping node. Let's put it between the texture coordinate and the wood texture. And then you can see this will automatically be connected. With this mapping node, as you can see, we can change the location, rotation and scale of the texture. Before we do that, let's take a quick look on the side here. Here you can see that on the top the texture looks nice, but here on the side this is stretched in this weird way. And that's because here on the wood texture, the projection is set to flat. This is like you would project a 2D flat image here from the top onto the 3D object, and then you get this stretching on the side. What we want to use instead here is the box projection. So let's click on box. Then you can see this image now will be projected from 6 sides onto the object like a box. Then we also have the texture here on the side. But if I zoom in pretty closely, you can see that we have this visible seam over here. However, the box method allows us to blend those if I increase the blend value over here. And then we don't see this seam anymore. So this box projection method is not perfect at all, but at least it helps us to create a quick result. And to be honest, in the end, we won't see the sides of the wooden planks anyway. So now we just need to scale this, and this we do with a scale value. However, if I, for example, increase the scale value here, the texture gets smaller. What we need to do instead is use a value between 0 and 1. 1 is basically the original scaling. With a value of 0.5, we doubled the size of the texture. But in this case, I tried this already, 0.25 works pretty well. Basically, we need to compare it with the size of the other objects in our scene here. So for my final scene, I don't want to have this nice bright wood. I want to have a dark wood. Certainly, I could put my original image into Photoshop or another image editor and then change the color and brightness there. But this is now too time consuming for me. I just want to do it quickly here on the fly in Blender. So let's hit Shift A, go to color and add a hue saturation node and put it in between the texture and the principal shader. This allows us to change the hue of the texture, the saturation, and also the brightness. So I want to have a dark wood. So let's set the value to 0.2. I also don't want to have this saturated color here. So let's set it down to 0.4. And let's also change the hue here to 0.45. So this gets a little bit more brownish tone. Certainly changing the hue only works if the texture has a color already. So now we have this dark brown wood. And now, again, as always, we need a simple roughness map and a bump map. So first of all, let's add a converter color ramp, plug this texture in here and use this for the roughness. But in this case, I don't want to have the dark areas to be shiny. I want to have the bright areas to be shiny. And in order to do that, we basically have to flip the color ramp. And this we can simply do by clicking here on this little arrow and click on flip color ramp. Now you can see all the bright areas will be more shiny and all the dark areas will be less shiny. So we can tweak this around if we like by changing these values. Maybe we increase the black a bit so we don't have like 100% reflection. And let's decrease the white values a bit so that none of the areas are 100% rough. And now to add the final touches here, let's hit Shift A again, go to vector, add a bump map. Connect this again with the wooden texture and the height input here, and then normal connect this with the normal of the principal shader. The wood texture needs to be a bit more rough, but certainly not that strong. I tried a value of 0.16, which fits quite well over here. Certainly, we can tweak this in the end, and what also helps over here to change the lighting maybe to one with a stronger light here, and then we can see how the wood looks like in the end. So I think that's okay for now. We will maybe tweak this in the end when we have our final lighting. Let's get back to the indoor lighting, which fits quite well to the scene we want to create. Yeah guys, as you can see, even with simple node setups in the shader editor, we can create some very cool looking materials. And as you maybe can imagine now, with using these nodes in the shader editor, you can do a lot of things, and we just scratched the surface here. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. If this is the case, give it a like, subscribe to our channel here, and ring the bell underneath this video to get notified for future videos. And if you want to extend your 3D knowledge and get even deeper deeper into Blender 2.8, you might enjoy our top-rated Blender 2.8 Launchpad course. This course includes roughly 200 short and fun lessons going over all the important fundamentals, not only Blender, but also 3D in general. We will do some fun exercises and we will create a full 3D animated scene from scratch. If you want to learn more, check the link in the video description. Yeah guys, thanks a lot for watching. Now check the next video where we will create the material for the fabric. Then we will learn how to use images with a transparent background to create the leaf, and we will also create the cutted apple. So a lot of exciting stuff. Don't miss this lecture. I will see you there. Goodbye.